The 3D scene node inside of Silhouette has allowed us to bring in camera tracking and point data to let us draw in 3D cards for painting and other compositing work. Now in Silhouette 2025.5 and above, we can use SynthEyes tracking technology to solve our scenes straight inside of Silhouette. My name is Ben Brownlee for Boris Effect. Let's take a look. And here's our first clip. So what we want to do is we want to track the scene to apply some different paint to it. So I can come either into the core Silhouette or transform categories and apply 3D scene. Now you'll see, in addition to being able to load a 3D scene, we're able to take in Alembic or FBX data. We also have camera tracking powered by SynthEyes technology, and we have a big solve. So if I click on this, we're going to find all the points of interest within the scene. It's going to tie those together between the frames. It's going to solve that camera and give us our camera data plus the point data there. And that goes really fast. In fact, it goes a lot faster than it took for me to explain what was going on. And if we look now at the object list, we can see we have the scene. So the camera has been transformed, as we can see there. Go. Transform matrix in there. So at this stage we would work as we have done in the past. So let's come in to select the points. I can hold down the shift key to add more points to our area. So selecting the points that are going to make up this card, bring in the card there and just select that one there, and we'll call this card mid. And I can do the same thing for the rest of them. So come in, select another group of points, and this will give me my second card, or the secondary solved plane, which I can then draw the card on like that. And I can even give it another color if I want to. So I move over to a version where I've actually already done the work. So we've got three solved planes. We've got the right, the left, and the mid. Let's take that data and see how we can work with that inside of Paint. So if I come up to enable stabilization in the viewer, so, and I'll choose which one I want. Let's go scene one. Let's take the left hand side here, and I'm going to click on unproject. And this is going to show us our unprojected version of the scene. I'm going to stop just before the edge of that one. And what I'm going to do is make sure that we have our transform set to our left, and hit on match move, and let's play all of that through. So now we're auto painting on the stabilized object, and we're seeing how it looks in its unprojected form. So it makes it a lot easier to unpick and see what's actually going on. Nice. Okay, and let's come up. Let's go into the mid one here. Change our transform to mid. Come in, and we'll do a slightly different shape. Show off one of my new brushes. I say the new, they're not that new anymore, actually. Oh, this is going to be so good. Same diff as before. Come in, make sure that's selected, make sure match move is on, and we'll play that through as well. And this will now repeat those same strokes on the second plane. And finally, the right hand card. Make sure I change my transform to right, and come over and do the final piece. Oh, so good. Now, if we take a look here, you'll see that if I repeated all of these strokes now, that's going to take in all of the strokes from both of the areas that I painted. So it's going to redraw the blue as well. And we don't want that. So we just want to make sure that we're only drawing in these final yellow strokes. So I can shift select these final ones here. And we see that those are the yellow ones we actually need, and auto paint the rest of those across the clip. So it's a small little thing, but you always should be aware when we're dealing with paint and auto paint to make sure that you've got your tracking set up properly, your work range set up properly, and the actual paint strokes that you want to repeat across the frames set up properly as well. And that looks good as well. So let's come in and turn off stabilization. Let's play back and look at that. and it can be a lot easier to paint on 3D projector cards than on planar tracked surfaces. Let's take a look at an example. All we've done in the 3D scene for the camera side is click on solve. If we take a look at some of the other controls we have down the bottom, we can choose what sort of motion that we're dealing with. You can also cue the solver in to the lens or camera movement with these things here. Is it on a tripod? So is it a nodal based pan? Well, let's have a little look. This one is definitely not a nodal based pan. Is it a locked shot? Nope, it's still moving around. Do we want to be working on the corners? Actually, yeah, I'm happy working on corners. We've got lots of corners in this scene here. The next section, the feature section, is where we're really able to start to affect how good our solve is. In fact, I'm going to just hit solve here to start with, and let's see what we get. Take a look down in the solve data area down here. We can see our average error is 0.7165, and we can see we've got green pretty much all the way through here. So what does this mean? Well, it means that the distance between the 2D trackers and the 3D solve trackers is on average 0.7165 horizontal pixels. And as a rule of thumb, we want that number to be less than one, because we don't want to see one pixel of drift. So that's pretty good though already. But we might need to throw some points in to be able to choose our planes correctly. Let's come back to the features. We have the minimum number of trackers per frame. This is set to 12. That's the minimum that it's going to need to get a decent solve out of it. So if I crank that up to 24, we'll see what difference that makes. With the max track count, this is the maximum number of 2D trackers that it's going to create from all of the interesting feature points. Now, my rule of thumb is that we should set this to around about the same number of frames that we have in our shot. So this shot is 421 frames long. So let's type in 450, because that's close here. I'm going to talk briefly about blip size. If you're working on high-res footage with lots of detail, turn that small blip size up. Similarly, if you have an out-of-focus shot without much detail in it, turn the large blip size up. Then adjust the other one. Another rule of thumb that I use is that the large blip size should be around about double the small. And if you want to know why, drop a comment down below and I'll record a longer video about it. But let's solve this and see what difference that makes. Remembering, of course, our previous error was 0.7165. So looking at this here, our average error rate has gone up to 0.9822. That's still below one, so it should still be fine, but it's higher than it was before. And if we look over towards the end, we can see that that's probably happening because it's picking up a lot more of the sea in the background. So if we take a look at the areas that are interesting to us, the ones on the actual tower itself, the lighthouse itself, those are looking pretty good. And it's shots like these that make me like using 3D scene solves instead of planar tracking. Look at the face of the lighthouse. Just going to select like a whole bunch of trackers here. And here's another little tip for you. If we select a lot of points on one frame, we might not know if those are exactly the points that are going through for the rest of the shot. So if I come through here, take a little look. A load of the points that I chose aren't on that actual plane. They're actually on the ground itself. We can also change the viewers to be 3D orthogonal views at this point too. But here's my rough and ready method. We saw before that if I hold down the shift key, I can add points in. If I hold down the control key, I can remove points from my plane. You'll also see, hang on, if I select that one again, you'll also see that there's a distance point here. So this kind of shows us that there's actually an error happening. These points now and the overall movement of the card. So let's just move that out of the way and you'll see that those points are actually better now. Right, let's try that again. We see those are all sat directly on the face that we want. Nice. And then I have a plane that I can draw straight on this side here. Now, the big reason for wanting to use 3D solve planes rather than traditionally plane attract planes is for these, particularly these types of shots, it makes it easy when the plane goes almost invisible at that point there. I'll unproject the viewer again and add paint to show you another gotcha if you're not being careful. Let's take it from here down round about here. So let's match move it to side one. Thank you very much. Come back in. Lovely. And you'll see that at some point, once it's gone beyond the frame, or beyond the plane, I should say, the unproject has just stopped working. Or it hasn't stopped working. It's just the viewer isn't showing us anything because it's trying to show some stuff that is physically impossible to happen. But if I turn off the enable here, or the stabilization here, just because it's impossible for us to see what's going on doesn't mean it's impossible for the paint to work. So the paint is still working. If we take a little look, there we go. We can see it right there. So the paint is still painting, even though we can't see it on the unprojected view. So remember at this point, let's just undo all of this. So it will just revert. What we want to do is set up a custom paint range. When the side that's actually visible stops being visible, we stop making any paint at that point. And that final frame is going to be around about frame, I mean here, really, 140, let's say. So let's come down, change that from work range to being custom, from 1 to 140. Take that and let's play that forward. And that's all you need to remember. There's another way to get better solves that I want to show you on our next shot. So let's see what happens when I add a 3D scene and just do the auto solve on this. Okay, so we've got an average error of 1.6242. That's not great. If we play this back, we've got a lot of points happening in the sea, which is not really useful for us. It's all far in the distance. And we've got almost nothing happening on the important stuff that we want to look at, which is the actual lighthouse itself. What we have on the 3D scene node, and in fact on all tracker nodes, is this thing called an occlusion mat. So what we can do is we can feed in a mat here to say, where do I not want the trackers to happen? So I'm just going to feed that into here. And let's use the occlusion mat. I could also use the source alpha if we have a source alpha, but we don't. I'm going to resolve the scene. I'm also going to turn my maximum tracker count up to fit the number of frames, more or less. Minimum trackers per frame. Let's crank that up as well. It won't have much of a difference. The big difference is going to be with that occlusion map, but let's see what happens when we resolve this. Okay, and now we can see that not only do we not have any of the C now being counted towards our tracking data, we have a lot more points in the areas where we're actually interested in them, and our average error, most important thing probably, is 0.78. And that's just by using the occlusion map that you can find on the left-hand side of the node. And remember, if you need more control over the solve than you have now, you can always import Alembic or FBX data in from a dedicated tracking solution like SynthEyes. Now, I hope this gives you a good grounding to the camera solver. If you have any questions, ask me in the comments. And if you want to try it for yourself, head over to boriseffects.com.